Welcome to QI for another wild leap into the dark. And teetering on the precipice tonight are the daring Sean Locke. The devil-may-care Jimmy Carr. The dauntless Joe Brown. And he doesn't even know the meaning of the word dastardly, Alan Davis. It's DDD all the way, and tonight it's D for danger. Danger in the face, with alarm calls to match. So, Sean, let's hear your alarm call. And Jimmy goes... And Joe...
Vehicle reversing.
Very nice, too. And Alan... You don't get more dangerous than a
mosquito, yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, in the next 24 hours, talking of danger, there is a 1 in 48 million risk of being burned to death while you sleep. There is a 1 in 30 million risk...
That would wake you up, wouldn't it?
It would.
How heavy a sleeper would you have to be to be burnt alive?
You could be quite pissed, couldn't you? I actually burnt my flat down when I was pissed.
You didn't put that on the insurance form, did you? I was pissed, that's how it happened.
You know what it's like, you just go, f*** it, sort it out in the morning.
Are you exaggerating? Was it cystitis?
Hey, you've got rather ladies' area quite early on in the show.
Thank you very much.
Dear me. Right, 1 in 30 million people risk dying by being murdered. The risk of choking to death is 1 in 120 million. And the risk of dying by tea cozy is 1 in 20 billion. There is, however, a 1 in 257,000 chance of you dying today during this programme.
What have you got planned for round two? Is there a tiger involved, is there?
If there happened to be 257,000 people playing QI at the moment, one of them would die. But it may be us. We don't
know.
Not
because of the game, though.
No. Just saying, you have a 1 in 257,000
chance.
Electrocuted
by the buzzer.
What are the chances of you dying in your sleep from a fire with a tea cosy over here?
You're 50 times more likely to die now than you are to win the lottery. I think we had a nurse standing by, frankly. Well, we have.
I'm not a proper nurse.
How not proper?
Psychiatric.
She's a stripper.
Do you think strippers get home at the end of the day and go, oh, more work?
Well, I think it's time for our first question. What is 3 times more dangerous than war?
Three wars.
Is it doing a U-ey on the A40?
This is according to the United Nations.
It's probably something really inane, like cycling, trampolining.
It's work. More likely to die at work than you are at war.
Does that include soldiers?
What if you work in a shoe shop near a war?
You always guarantee you will find some cunning way to make me not know anything. And I don't know what the statistics are for people who work in shoe shops near wars.
How many times have they actually had a war in a shopping centre? It's very rare that first world countries get invaded, but if they did, you could have a shootout in a multiplex, couldn't you?
If you lived in South London, you'd find a lot of wars in shopping centres.
I've been arrested in a shopping centre.
Have you? Tell us why.
For an act of war?
I knocked a security guard's hat off.
Oh, a very Bertie Wooster thing to do.
Yeah. I didn't even do it on purpose, I was taking my jumper off. I was absolutely arsehole as well.
And you're very much hearing my side of the story. Yeah. I called it actually rather a story of defence.
I read a thing once that said a third of all accidents at work go unreported. How do they know?
Lumberjacks have the most dangerous job in America, it appears. 122 deaths per 100,000 employees.
So that song's entirely wrong, is it?
Yes. Exactly.
How could you die doing that? Just trees falling on you?
You're saying trees falling on you like that's a bit of a pansy way to go. That's, that's a legitimate way to die.
It's just the only real sort of peril, isn't it?
There's a lot of chainsaws.
But also, you're not very well protected in panties and a bra, are you?
And also, if you're a lumberjack, you're supposed to be good at it. Yeah. It's not supposed to chop down trees and go, oh, it's the other side, isn't it?
Oh, no!
The single most dangerous specific job is said to be an Alaskan crab fisherman.
Is this most dangerous jobs in America? Because how many presidents have they had? They've had a lot of those go.
But only three have been assassinated.
Three have been assassinated and one had a blowjob in the office. It can't go either way. Yeah.
It's swings
not a job you turn down straight away.
Well, no, yes. According to the United Nations, more than 2 million people die from work-related accidents, as opposed to 650,000 people a year who die in wars. Now, what was the most dangerous military stratagem ever devised?
Vehicle reversing.
Was it Hannibal's first crack at the Alps with chihuahuas?
The purpose of this one was to terrify the enemy. Imagine you're in the front line of an army and you're massing against the front line of another army, and the front line of the opposing army does something so extraordinary that you think, oh my God, we're never going to beat them.
Is it from a Carry-On film? Is it when they lifted their when they lifted their kilts and they didn't wear pants? It was amazing.
Carry-On Braveheart. No, it's neither of those.
They flagellate themselves. They insert something within them.
They chop their own heads off.
They chop their own heads off.
Their own heads.
The front line of the army chops their heads off. How you do that? Grab your hair and just slice with a very sharp sword.
Who was that then? The Scots Guards.
This was in 496 BC.
It would be the Swiss Army because they'd have something on one of those little knives.
No, wouldn't they? Self decapitation. It's a country you know well, and you're wearing its flag at the moment.
This is the flag of Vietnam.
Well, that's right. We're talking 496 BC, the army of King Gujian of Yue. And he had convicted criminals in the front line and told them they had to cut their own heads off. You may say, well, why would they do that?
What's the worst that could happen?
The worst that could happen was if they didn't, then all their families and all their children would be massacred as well.
Fuck it.
They didn't seem to worry. They knew they were going to die anyway. They were condemned to death. What do we know about decapitation? Does it kill you straight away?
I know if you cut a duck's legs off, it can still swim.
It can float, but it can't swim.
Float? A floating duck.
I'll leave a little bit of stumpage. No.
It wouldn't be. It would have to catch the currents. It would evolve into a whole different animal. It would probably get a wing up as a sail or something like that.
Didn't they discover, like, for example, at the French Revolution with the guillotine, that, like, heads could kind of, like, chat about it?
Carry on chatting. So...
Well, no, you're right. There was a story during the terror of the French Revolution that two members of the National Assembly were guillotined and their heads put in the same bag straight away, and one bit the other so hard they couldn't be separated. What, just the heads?
Mm. That's holding a grudge, isn't it? For all intents and purposes, you're dead. Let it go. Yeah, you didn't get on. Whatever.
They were friends. Well, anyway, from decapitation to another kind of danger, what is the most dangerous sport in fact, the most dangerous country in the world?
Contemporary dance in Scotland. Hopscotch in Afghanistan? I don't know.
You're very close.
Well, it's going to be Afghanistan or Iraq, isn't it? Well, quite two
odd enough, in between those two...
Kazakhstan.
No, a much better-known one.
Subazakistan?
It's another Stan, but the best-known Stan.
Uzbekistan.
Pakistan.
Pakistan.
Pakistan. Pakistan.
They play a lot of cricket.
They do play cricket there, but they also have this very dangerous sport. So dangerous, it's been banned for all but 15 days of the year. It's a child's pastime that has become aggressive and extreme.
Conkers?
No. It's mentioned and indeed sung about in Mary Poppins.
Buckaroo?
Mary Poppins.
Flying a kite.
Flying a kite. The idea of extreme kite flying
is dangerous.
You have to sever your
head?
Competitors. You have to sever your competitor's kite from its string. And so the string's actually made of metal with glass, sharp, abrading glass. And motorcyclists get garroted because hundreds of people do it all over the country.
Who told you this, Stephen? This is not. This doesn't happen.
I'm afraid it does.
No, I saw it, Channel 5, when kiters go bad.
They shout, Bo Katter, kite down.
What about when they garrot someone? What do they shout then?
Oops. Yes, probably. It's the Spring Festival of Vasant Panchami, or Basant is when it happens. And there's people against it, the Kite Flying Effectees Committee. People who are affected by kite flying have tried to ban it completely.
Do all the kites have to have the face of Des Lynam on them?
He is a god in Pakistan.
Yeah.
How big can a kite be? What's the heaviest kite
you
could have?
They could weigh anything up to 4 tons.
Well, the largest kite ever made weighs nearly a ton.
It's 100 meters
48
long.
Foot by 36 foot.
That's
and
right.
How many people does it take to fly that then?
50.
50 people.
People, yeah. 50 men, it says here.
50 men or 25 fat birds.
It has 200 strings. The smallest is 1.25 inches across.
You can get them in the market and stuff. You see those blokes that are in those tiny kites? Have you seen them?
No.
Miniature kites.
That's right.
On bridges and things or something.
Oh, do they? You started using an electric fan, one of those little handheld electric fans. Just fires up. Yeah. Invisible string, which makes it very pleasing. Because
then
so
you go
fine.
Home and cry. What am I doing? What the hell am I doing in my life? I want to be a doctor.
Oh, Lord. Look, everybody.
Oh, what's that point?
So, name the world's most dangerous manager.
It's not Dave the Decapitator, who's head of Psychos R Us in Catford.
No.
Not Chernobyl Health and Safety or something, is it?
No, that would count.
Is it some like Evel Knievel's manager?
Very like Evel Knievel's manager, only go back in time to the Niagara Falls.
Blondin's manager.
Absolutely right. I think you should get 10 points for that. Thank Blondin's you. Manager. And for the boys and girls, tell us who Blondin was.
He was a famous tightrope walker.
He was the most famous tightrope walker of his day. But he also carried his manager across, which was a disaster, because his manager was a lot heavier than him, and Blondin liked slippery tights. And stopped 6 times because he was so heavy. It was on the 17th of August, 1859, and it took 42 minutes.
Is that his manager, then, or just some bloke that wanted to get to the other side?
He'd take eggs and a frying pan and a trivet and matches, and he'd stop halfway across and make an omelette and then eat it. Or he'd take a lion and a wheelbarrow across with him.
Really? No.
A lion?
Yeah.
What was his manager giving him?
Did he eventually die by falling off one?
No, he died, actually. He died in...
Tea cosy.
I thought it said that he died in a bed of diabetes. No, he died in bed of diabetes. Not in a bed, it's one of the restaurant menus. Nestling in a bed of diabetes. No, he died in bed, age 73.
But actually, they have terrible trouble, don't they, stopping people trying to go over the Niagara Falls, because people are always trying to get in a barrel, and I've no idea why, but they have to have special security men, because apparently there's endless kind of trucks reversing up with sort of concealed barrels. And people just going, right, push me, Dave, I'm... going. Apparently, there's enough people that want to do that for them to have to really.
They do stop it. There have been 16 known barrel drops, and 6 of those have ended in mortality. The first to do it was a woman.
Hey.
Yes, Annie Taylor.
Didn't want to.
That's a honeymoon that's gone horribly wrong.
Now, Annie Taylor was the first to do it. And she was something of a heroine for doing it. She was, there she is, look. Well, battle axe she looks, I mean, God. But there's her barrel.
She's all right.
With her name on it. Annie Edson Taylor, heroine of Niagara Falls, it says. And Bobby Leach was the second man to do it. The third man to do it was a Briton, Charles Stevens, and he did it with his legs tied to an anvil. By this time, people were really bored with the feat by two people having done it.
I think it's really nice they went to all the effort of writing their names on
Isn't
the barrels.
It? Well, he couldn't because he tied it to an anvil in that rather sort of roadrunner-y way, you know, kind of thing. And all they found of him was a severed arm inside the barrel with a tattoo on it saying, "Forget me not, Annie." People were obsessed with the Niagara Falls. They had this pirate ship and they filled it with animals, bears and geese and all kinds of things, and sailed it off the top of Niagara. And only two geese survived. Two bears crawled out and they were shot. For cowardice. So, now, what's the most dangerous sporting activity for women?
Foxy boxing.
Foxy boxing.
Foxy boxing.
Cheerleading somewhere like Iraq would be tough, wouldn't it? You know, it's
very I'm going to
country.
Give you.
Cheerleading would be quite.
I'm going to give you the money. The points. Money.
No, I want the money.
Start playing for money. What I don't
know. Actually, Stephen, I really want the car. I know it's behind me.
You get the points because the answer is simply cheerleading.
Really?
Cheerleading is the most dangerous. More injuries and deaths are sustained by women engaged in cheerleading than any other sporting activity. The best-known cheerleader in America is...
Nancy George Reagan.
Bush. George Bush is the right answer. How did you actually know that?
Yes, well, he did it. It's the thanks.
Yes.
it was the only sporting activity. It's what he did. He didn't play sports.
Absolutely right. He had special T-shirts made with Go Nads, which was the name of his team. Go Nads. You see?
I've never seen cheerleaders that aren't in a shower.
Yeah.
I thought that's what they did. Yeah. I thought they were just obsessed by lather.
Other dangerous sports, bungee jumping, do you know anything about that?
You can get a detached breast tissue.
What, at the gift shop afterwards or?
Because if you go in the nude, they let you do it for free.
Where? Everywhere? Or at a particular site you know of?
And you can, if you don't have proper support, your breasts, because of the gravitational pull, can fly clean off. And you can also get detached retina.
And if you shout at a breast that's just been decapitated, as it were, does it still respond for the next 30 seconds?
It will still lactate for half an hour.
Still express itself, quite literally.
I like to think of... I like to think of bungee jumping as suicide for indecisive people. It's like a tester, isn't it?
It is.
Oh, no, I'll be all right with this, yeah. I heard a brilliant story about, you know, the Darwin Awards. Obviously, every year they have these Darwin Awards for people taking themselves out of the gene pool. And there was a brilliant story of a guy that he was, you know, drunk one night and he decided, right, what I'm going to do is bungee jump. His mates went, "You won't be able to." He went, "I will." Just got a tow rope and jumped off a bridge. Obviously, that foot just snapped off and he landed in a freezing river.
No feet. He couldn't swim.
So, take me back, because it's a good letter deed for Darwin. I don't know the Darwin Awards. When you say take yourself out of the gene pool...
Well, it's stories from around the world of people that have killed themselves in such stupid ways.
Killed themselves, right.
There's another brilliant one of a guy that was sitting in his back garden and he had got a couple of balloons and filled them up with helium or whatever so that he would float. He thought it'd be brilliant if I could float and drink beer. Wouldn't that be lovely? It'd be so comfy in a garden chair. He went about a mile up and froze to death.
What an arse! But I see what you mean. Taking out of the gene pool, in other words, the human gene pool does not need those kind of people to pass on their genes to the next generation.
Indeed. Yeah. It's the reason why they should allow people to walk down to railway tracks if they so wish. Because, you know what? You don't need them. If they can't work out a train's coming...
Right.
Let's face it, the gene pool needs a little chlorine. You know who you are.
Who invented bungee jumping and when?
That was the New Zealanders, wasn't it?
It was actually a British invention in 1979.
The bungee strap is a British invention.
Yeah.
Hurrah!
Good on.
And they never, ever, ever break.
That must be a real comfort to the families of the people that the rope was too long.
Yeah.
Yeah, the rope, if you want, it's still perfect. Oh, thanks.
Yeah,
was now.
You can have another go with the coffin. Oh, into the grave, out the grave.
Oh, it must happen. I want that to happen.
Well, well, I'm redrafting my will tomorrow.
Yeah, exactly. You've sorted out all our funeral requirements. Oh, excellent. Another dangerous sport is Russian roulette, of course.
That's dangerous.
Yes.
In the early days, you had a musket, you'd only have the one.
That was a man's game. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, it's 6-1.
What we do know is that in 2005, more than 200,000 cheerleaders had to attend medical facilities with cheerleading-related injuries. It's time, ladies and gentlemen, how could it not be, for us to dare to dip into the deep end of the pool of half-dissolved truths and sheer undiluted mythery that we call general ignorance, so fingers on buzzers, please. What causes deep vein thrombosis on aeroplanes? Oh, you're in first.
Sitting still phrases and getting a blood clot.
Ooh! Sitting down for too long.
Oh, hello. Is it the 5 pasties you had before you set off?
Well, it turns out, according to a Lancet article, that if you put people in exactly the same conditions as on a cramped aeroplane, but on dry land in an ordinary room, they don't get the increased chances of DVT. Oh. That it's actually the poor air quality.
And you know the air quality on planes is worse now that they've stopped you smoking.
I know, exactly right. It's very bad air indeed up there, and they save a lot of money on it being bad air. And it also seems to be a contributory factor to DVT. But there are these compression socks. There was an article in the newspaper very recently about them actually working.
They're hugely sexually attractive, those.
Well, they stopped calling them surgical stockings because that sounds so kind of Les Dawson old lady. And they now call them compression socks. It sounds slightly
I think
butch.
I like those socks because
you
put them on.
You would do, because you're sort of quite pervy, aren't you?
Well, here's the thing I like about them. It's a really tight sock, and when you take it off, it's lovely and itchy. It's very satisfying somehow.
Do you have bald chins?
Do I have bald chins?
Old enough now to have bald chins? The lower shin?
I don't know what you've been up to, Stephen, to be honest.
You know,
I can't even conceive of how you've got
As men age, the hair stops growing in the lower part of the shin.
Does it?
You must have
noticed
that.
Oh, no, I've got virtual quiffs down there.
Have you? You're still pretty hairy down there. Yeah. Brushed by the tip of your penis as well, I can see that. Most impressive.
I've got to get that reattached.
With women, it's the other way around. My bikini line's wound around my ankles at the moment.
So, fingers again on buzzers. How much sleep should you have every night?
Vehicle reversing.
Go back.
4 hours.
Good answer.
4 hours?
4 to 7 hours, you'll live a lot longer than if you have 8 hours every night. People who have 8 hours or more live shorter lives.
Yeah, but if you only sleep 4 hours a night, it can lead to dismantling the welfare state.
Margaret Thatcher is a famous example, which very well put, of someone who didn't get that much sleep.
Yeah, no wonder, really, what she did to the miners.
Yeah, right. The average Briton gets 6 or 7 hours sleep a night, as opposed to their grandparents or great-grandparents in 1900, where 9 hours a night was the average. Certainly people lived less long, but for all kinds of reasons. What scale do seismologists use to measure earthquakes? Sean.
The Richter scale.
Oh! No, they don't. Seismologists don't. Journalists often do still these days, but not for 30 years nearly. They use something else. It's called the MMS, the Moment Magnitude Scale.
You're sure? Absolutely sure.
Yes.
Sure. I got that wrong.
You did, but you kindly went it around. There's an example of what happens after an earthquake. The angles, it's rather like Renaissance Mannerist art. The diagonals are very... The composition is excellent.
I hate Renaissance Mannerist art, don't you?
Do you?
Yeah, it's crap.
Michelangelo, for example? No?
Michelangelo?
Don't like him?
Bollocks.
No. He was particularly good at bollocks, it must be said. It's one thing he absolutely thrived.
Has he been spotted in Heat magazine? Michelangelo spotted buying pants in Primark.
Primark.
Do you get yours made specially by the Queen's tailor?
I thought you'd had yours done on a loom by Exquisite Boys.
This was
stopped. We're making Stephen's pants.
I can't wear these. He's got a mole on his face.
Oh God, help! Where and when was the largest earthquake in the United States of America?
Oh.
There, on the left.
The big long one, where everyone lives. The long bit.
You mean San Francisco, 1906?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, thank you so much. You're a true gentleman. It was not the largest. It was certainly perhaps the most catastrophic. It killed...
3,000.
Now, you say it killed 3,000 people. A rather disturbing fact about it is it killed 3,000 white people. They didn't count the Chinese dead. Isn't that horrible? A quarter of a million made homeless. But the major cause of death and destruction was not the actual...
Fires.
It was the fires.
Raging fires.
And why did a lot of fires come about, do you think?
A flame.
Thank you very much.
Was it because they
leaping
were all
from
really
building to building?
Fed up, so they all got pissed and fell asleep?
No.
Gas.
Because they weren't insured against earthquake, but they were insured against fire. So a lot of people started setting fire to their houses when they saw that they were cracked.
When the insurance company would go, oh, what are the chances? It burned down the same day, did it?
Oh.
Imagine my surprise.
Some genuine fires were caused by the fact that there was a gas main and that would go up. You know, it was at a time when there was gas lighting and heating all over the city.
I think I might know where the largest earthquake was.
Yes, same.
I think it might be Yellowstone National Park. Because there's a supervolcano underneath it.
Well, you're probably right. I would have to add the right of the question, since European settlement. There may well have been a huge one in Yellowstone.
Whoa.
It's a bit late for that, Stephen.
A bit late for that.
You wouldn't have said 1906 if I hadn't said since European settlement.
No.
Just on the subject of San Francisco fire, this is an example of how nasty it was. When the fire caught the Windsor Hotel at 5th and Market Streets, there were three men on the roof and it was impossible to get them down. Rather than see the crazed men fall in with the roof and be roasted alive, the military officer decided to direct his men to shoot them, which they did, in the presence of 5,000 people. And there was another man who started burning...
The entertainment back then was rubbish!
Another man screamed and begged to be killed as his feet began to burn, and he was up on a roof then. And the policeman took his name and address and then shot him through the head. Took his name and address.
This is my house.
No, actually, the greatest earthquake, certainly since European settlement, was that in New Madrid, Missouri, in the Mississippi Valley, during 1811 and 1812. Or you may prefer the one in Prince William Sound, in Alaska in 1964. Either way, the more famous San Francisco earthquake was just simply not in the same class. I think it brings us really handily to the end of the quiz on this particular occasion. And looking at the scores, there's astounding, astounding things going on, because way out in first place with 7, Joe Brand, ladies and gentlemen. In second place with a very handy 4 points, Sean Locke.
Thank you. Thank you.
Neither up nor down, but in third position with 0 points, it is Jimmy. Which means our runaway fourth place goes to the minus 19 of Alan Davis. Wow. And my thanks to Jimmy, Sean, Joe and Alan. I'll leave you with the observation of former Prime Minister David Lloyd George. The most dangerous thing in the world, he said, only in a Welsh accent, is to try to leap a chasm in two jumps. So from all of us, AccuI, good night.
Clive Anderson, Vic Reeves and Arthur Smith join the panel in the next QI, and you can watch that right now over on BBC4 or simply wait till next Friday at 10 here on BBC2.